back to Who Wants to Be a Radical Queer Performance Artist? Sunny the Duck. Our contestant, Rudy Ramirez, has done extremely well so far. He's answered question after question correctly, and we're now only two questions away from the grand prize, a career as a radical queer performance artist. Rudy, how are you feeling?
Good, Sunny.
Now, let me remind you that it's not too late to turn back. You can walk out of here right now with all your winnings and begin a career as a gay performance artist. A lot of them out there, very successful. So, the question is, do you want to play it safe or do you want to play the game?
I'm going to play the game.
Play the game. Let's play Who Wants to Be a Radical Queer Performance Artist? Rudy, here is your question. What fierce Latina trans rights activist who famously uttered the phrase "Hell hath no fury like a drag queen scorned" started the street transvestite action revolutionaries and is often credited with throwing the first bottle at the cops at the Stonewall riots in 1969? Was it A, Alison Ayante, B, Katiria Reyes, C, Silvia Rivera, or D, Sandra Salinas?
Oh God, no.
What's wrong?
I know this woman's Sunny, but I cannot remember her name.
Oh no.
My friend Scott has a poster of her on his wall. It's right in the store. I can see it, but I can't remember her name.
And you already used your phone-a-friend lifeline on the vaginal fisting safety question. Don't you know the names look familiar?
I'm Mexican, Sunny. All the names look familiar.
We still have one lifeline left. Poll the audience.
I guess I gotta use it.
All right, audience, you heard him. We have no budget on Who Wants to Be a Radical Queer Performance Artist, so we're going to have to do it by applause. Who thinks A, Alison Ayante, B, Katiria Reyes, C, Silvia Rivera, or D, Sandra Salinas? So that's what the audience thinks, Rudy. What do you think?
I mean, I gotta go with C, Silvia Rivera.
Is that your final answer?
Yes.
Silvia Rivera is correct. And you are closer to being a radical queer performance artist. Now, we've arrived at our final question. The last stop on the road to radical queer performance artist. Are you ready?
Ready, Sunny. Let's do this.
All right. Your final question. How does queer liberation begin?
Aren't you going to read the answers?
This is not a multiple choice question.
I'm a graduate, Sunny. I like to see the answers before I start thinking about a question.
How does queer liberation begin?
It is written.
Is that your final answer?
Brothers and sisters, no! Not brothers and sisters, for you are so much more than the narrow confines of any one gender. I have seen the promised land, a valley nestled in the Appalachian hills, beautiful even in winter, where the trees on the mountain are bare and the soil is covered in dead leaves. It is a land of milk and honey, or at least something creamy like milk and sticky like honey, that waits for you, as it waited for me after my years lost in the wilderness, on the night that I journeyed up the mountainside to find a pair of houses, like lovers, dark but for the warmth and laughter coming through the windows. That love and laughter is waiting for you, my people, and I call you now to come home, for I have seen the promised land, and it has outhouses. Okay, the outhouses were a problem. I'm a city kid. I don't do the outdoors. The outdoors lacks plumbing. I need plumbing. Plumbing has been, since the pre-classical Minoans, the cornerstone of human civilization. I mean, I once drove through Mexico for 3 hours with my ass clenched tight, all right, because I refused to stop and use an outhouse. So imagine this kid. After about 15 hours driving northeast from Texas, getting lost down a poorly marked mountain road that crossed a highway twice and yet still insisted it was southbound, going over a gravel road and over a dry creek bed to park by a barn in the middle, by the way, of the Appalachian winter, walking through the barn with only the light of my cell phone to keep me from dripping over a rake or a marmot or whatever the hell else lives in the woods, right? Going up to the first of two houses, opening up the door where my glasses instantly fog up and all I can see are these vague shapes carrying trays of hot something. Hi, I'm Rudy. I came from Austin. I'm looking for some friends of mine here from Austin. Oh, I think they might be at the house. The house? The building next door. Now, the kitchen is for cooks only until dinner is ready. So if you don't mind. Oh, sorry. Okay, so go back outside. Go to the other house where I open the door where I see a bunch of people moving around furniture and cleaning up the place, all right? Hi, I'm Rudy. I'm looking for some friends of mine from Austin. Oh, yeah. They're over at the neighbor's milking the cow. Milking the cow. And do you know when they'll be done? No, but a few of us are going to go over there in a couple minutes if you want to join. Oh, that's great. Thank you so much. Can I use your bathroom? Oh, sure. It's outside. What? What do you show? What was your name again? Rudy? What do you show Rudy where the outhouse is? The outhouse has a name. Princess. And it's pink. It is beautifully decorated in a gingerbread style. It could have been made of gold and surrounded by unicorns, and I would not have been any less freaked out, all right? It was unlit, it was unheated, it smelled exactly the way you would expect it to smell. There was a bucket of ashes by the hole, which I knew you were supposed to pour in after you were done to cut down on the smell because I'd read about it in fantasy novels, all right? I sat down and I barely managed to fart before I pulled my pants right back up and started making my way to my car thinking, all right, I can make it back to that hotel motel I saw by the side of the highway in like about an hour, maybe even make it partway back to Texas before it gets too late, but then I remembered that I'd come there to this radical queer living community in the middle of Bible Belt Red State America because it was my last resort, my last stop on the way to deciding that I wasn't gay or queer or anything anymore. I mean, I had this really great life in Austin where I was surrounded by really awesome queer women and trans men who did not want to date cis men, or at the very least, did not want to date me, or maybe, in retrospect, I was probably making some problematic assumptions. But, you know, I could never find that many other gay guys who were also radical queer. I mean, I felt like the last unicorn, you know? Wandering through the woods looking for another unicorn to rub horns with. I mean, I could get laid. Anyone could get laid if they tried hard enough. And I could sometimes, you know, get with really, really hot guys, but, I mean, something was missing. Something never felt right. I mean, I had been out for almost 12 years, and I still had not found something that fit. Hi. Welcome to Gay Identities R Us. My name is Topher. How may I help you today? I was told to come here for my gay identity. Oh, and if by the looks of it, whoever told you that was doing you a favor. But don't worry, we're going to fix you right up today. Now, there's a lot of things to consider. First of all, how much sex do you want to be having? Oh, a lot of sex. What about a committed relationship? Do you want one of those? Sure, I mean, eventually, I guess. How old are you? I'm 17. 17? Why didn't you say so in the first place? If you're 17, you have got to take the twink. The twink! The perfect identity for a gay man under 25. And it comes with such a wide variety to choose from. Do you like to dance? Oh, I love to dance. Well then, why not try the club kid twink? Bright colors, shiny metallics go great with this one. The hair is short, spiky, and gel, probably some blonde tips. Oh, I don't think I could go blonde. Do you like indie music? Sure. Well, then why not consider the hipster twink? You can keep your hair dark, maybe grow it a little longer. Oh, I think I'd like that. And you're a winter, which is great, because the hipster twink lives in dark colors, gray, blue. They love it, all right? Now, are you willing to listen to only bands no one has ever heard of and drink absinthe? As long as it's not beer, I think we have a winner. I'll take it. Awesome. What size are you? Well, I've had an eating disorder for the past year. Fantastic. And I'm down to a size 36 jeans. Oh, 36. Hang on. We don't seem to have that in that large of a size. Would you be willing to gain weight? Gain weight? You can be a bear, you know? The heavyset, hairy gay guys? Are you hairy? A little? We're off to a great start. Now, the bear comes with leather. How do we feel about leather? We think leather could have some potential. We're also going to have to get you some flannel. Flannel? Do you not like the flannel? Girl, we look like ass in the flannel. Okay, I guess we can do like jean shirts or something, but no, you're really going to have to butch it up, you know, act manly. Don't say girl. You know, drive a motorcycle or a pickup truck and drink beer. Oh, wait, you said you didn't want to drink beer, right? No, I hate beer. And I don't want to have to act manly. I mean, you know, I'm into musical theater and fishnets and, you know, and can I be a bear without having to be manly? You did say you wanted to get laid, didn't you? Do you have anything else? Of course we do, darling. Don't you fret. If all else fails, we'll just put you in Abercrombie and Fitch. I despise that store with a passion that almost exceeds my passion for dick. You know what's the most important word in that sentence? Almost. What sports do you play? I don't. Well, then jock is out of the question. Oh, I'm just devastated. Sarcasm. I have got the perfect look for that. Bitter queen. You get to wear the most stylish clothes and quote Oscar Wilde. Oh, that actually does sound fun. It is expensive, though. Those clothes get pricey, and you will have to lose weight unless you want to edit a fashion magazine. Is there any identity that does not require me to lose weight? Well, I mean, there's always the funny, flaming, chubby queen who comes in for comic relief. Well, that sounds a lot more likely, like me. Well, this one doesn't come with sex, though. Vale, me Dios, que voy a pedir soco en pinche. Wait, are you Mexican? Mexican-American? Why didn't you tell me we have a whole line for Mexicans? Right, yes, there's the sexy gardener, sexy auto mechanic, sexy pool boy. What? Not in the labels, no worries. If you want something more versatile, I've got a couple of really great Latin slut looks. There's the evil Latin slut who tries to break up the white boyfriends, usually because one of them is rich. I would never do anything like, or there's the stupid Latin slut who just sort of comes between the two white guys who really should be together. Where does this come from? Have you not seen a gay movie yet? Lie Down with Dogs, Billy's Hollywood Screen Kiss, Love, Valor, Compassion. It did win a Tony for its portrayal of two white lovers torn apart by a vicious Latin whore. I think I'm just gonna go. Oh, now don't be like that. I mean, if you want something more, some non-slut outfit, I mean, there's always the white man's devoted lover. We call it the Philadelphia. Here's the Tina drag queen. You've got the legs for it. If you would like to look at our menu today, you will not find it, because why should I write things down when I can tell you what you're having, seeing as you only got three options. We got a vegetarian pot pie, a vegan pot pie, and our special tonight, vegan pot pie with vegetarian gravy, which, let's face it, pretty much makes it a vegetarian pot pie. Now, as usual, we would ask everyone who is not vegan, please do not take any of the vegan pot pie until everyone who is vegan has gotten a piece. You can help yourself to the vegan pot pie vegetarian gravy, because like I said, gravy pretty much makes it not vegan anymore. All of our pie crusts and gravies are dairy-free for the benefit of those lactose intolerant. And speaking of intolerance, there was a lengthy debate about the necessity of peas in a pot pie, but after some conflict mediation, a consensus was reached, and peas are now available on the side. As for my name, well, it ain't Martha Stewart. And if you want me to be a server, I got bad news for you, because in about 5 minutes, my ass will be on this chair, my feet will be on another chair, and if you want to go past me, you better just walk around. Serve yourself. And if you run into one of the women who made this wonderful meal for you, act like your mama taught you, and say thank you. So I'm back in the kitchen, all right? You know, still worried, still not having gone to the bathroom. But thinking to myself, you know, I was told to come here to find what I was looking for. But as I look around, I think, you know, If I was looking for a really awesome vegetarian meal prepared by queer women, I would have just stayed in my house and asked my roommates to do it, all right? I mean, you know, Austin was, again, all, and this was not just Austin, you know, my entire life, actually, has been about being surrounded by awesome queer women. A friend of mine once said it makes me a dyke tyke, and I love that term. You know, because, like, they accepted me, and, you know, and they were friends with me, and you know, they take me to this magical realm called Deep Les. And, you know, a lot of them joke with me. They would say, you know, Rudy, you're a bigger dyke than all of us. But the truth is I wasn't. I mean, I'm still a mostly mainly gay guy who wants to, like, make out with other mostly mainly gay guys, like those two guys over there. And wait, what? Oh, my God, they're here. They've come out of the woods to feed. They look nothing like Homo domesticus. I mean, they're kind of scraggly and scruffy and, like, not polished. I mean, they look a lot like the straight anarchist guys I know back home. So maybe, just maybe, they're talking about Meryl Streep movies they love. They are gay. Okay, so all you do, all right, so I'm going to sit down next to them. I think to get my pot pie and go sit down next to them in a nonchalant manner and begin a conversation. All right, so pot pie. All right, come on, move your line. Come on, damn it, someone's next to the right king. Thank you. Not vegan, no, it's vegetarian gravy. Great, awesome. Shit. All the seats next to them are taken. Okay, that's fine. I can just sit here right next to you. No, those are dead. Well, it's over there by the couch, there's... No. All right. Well, I guess I will just sit on the floor. Silly. You know what I can do? I can just, like, eat this quickly, maybe go out for seconds, and then I can say, oh, great, one of them's leaving. God, okay, that means there's now a seat open next to the other one, so just get up, go over there, and talk to him. Get up, go over there, and talk to him. Get up, go over, okay, if you can't talk to him, at least talk to someone around here. I mean, just quit sitting on the floor being just... All right. This is feeling pretty typical when I think about it, so if this is really a place I'm looking for, I need something, all right? I need something to enjoy, I should be here. I need a sign that I should stay.
Oh, look at this stuff. Isn't it neat?
What?
Wouldn't you think my collection's complete?
Across the table.
Wouldn't you think I'm that girl, the girl who has everything?
Sing the song.
Look at this trove, treasures untold.
Oh, where does it go from there?
How many wonders can one cavern hold? Hi, I'm Rudy. I came up here from Austin. And this is it. This is the sign. I know people talk, but God damn it, I can sing.
Yeah. Sing.
Where the queer men are. I wanna see them dancing, lying around on that, what's that stuff on the ground outside, the green with bugs in it that's gross?
Grass.
Ew. I mean, my Austin life is a lot of fun, but guys I require for fucking, sucking, taking it right up the, what's that word again?
Pass.
Somewhere they're brave, somewhere they're free, somewhere they're gonna make out with me, then it's on mine. Someday I'll find part of that world. What would I give if I could live out of these boxes? What would I pay just to be gay without being thin? I bet you I'll find a man with a mind that thinks of more than Abercrombie. Liberated, dreams unfaded, ready to win. Had a ready to queer every last frontier. Not just get married and move to the suburbs, ready to take on and tear down that, what's the word, white capitalist heteropatriarchy. My joint to get it on with a radical boy. In gender, fuck drag. Please let this fag be part of that world. So I didn't sing that version. And, you know, it got me talking. It got me talking to these amazing people around me, you know, and not the guys yet, baby steps, but... You know, this really awesome women who made this great meal, and then they showed me to tell me there's a room in a back cabin and I could sleep there for the night. So, through the woods, through the dark, with only a flashlight, we go back there, right? So, if I have to use the bathroom during the night, do I have to go all the way back to Princess? God, no. Wait, are you telling me that there's another outhouse near the back cabin? Of course there is. We call that one the rocket ship. The cabin is about as cold as the outhouse was, and there is a dead spider hanging from the ceiling. I wait till this wonderful person gets outside the door before I have my full tilt boogie, hypothermic, arachnophobic, I still need to go to the bathroom, panic attack. Oh my God, I hate the woods. I hate nature. I hate bugs. I hate the outdoors. I hate the cold. I hate that I still haven't gotten to the bathroom yet. I hate that there are guys out there who can only use the outhouses, but are probably digging new ones for all I know. Why did I think this was going to work? I mean, I may not be a twink or a bear, but I am, and I always have been, an indoor kid. Brothers and sisters, I have seen the promised land. It's a land so sweet that the ground is made of cookies and the mountains made of cake. Every winter, powdered sugar falls from the sky. You can walk in woods with pretzel stick trees and gumdrop leaves. A blue sugar sprinkle river runs through it, and if you grab a rock from the banks and bite into it, you will taste chocolate. Gummy worms till the soil in the garden, and everyone lives in a gingerbread house. I have seen the promised land, and it is covered in cream cheese frosting. So, next morning, I go to the kitchen to say thank you and also goodbye. All right? I'm going to leave. Until I see the cake. It is a scale model replica of the valley that we're all staying in. All right? Being covered in cream cheese frosting by guys. Many more than the night before. Who knew they were diurnal? And who knew they were so attractive? I mean, you know, I was gonna leave, but you know, maybe I was being hasty. Maybe I can stay for a little while and talk about, oh God. No, I think it is in fact time to go. I should be making my, hey, I'm going to the grocery store in town. Anybody wanna come with? Can I come with you to see the town? I would really love to see the town. So, back on the road, clenching really tight, but with the promise of sweet relief, I attempt to make some conversation. So, how long have you been living here? I've been here about a couple years now, but people have been living here since about, you know, since more than 20 years now, I think. Awesome. So what's the reason for the party that's happening right now? Oh, well, we just bought this land, actually. That sounds amazing. So you've been here for a couple of years. I mean, where did you live before that? Oh, before that, I lived in San Francisco. San Francisco? Yeah, I lived there myself once. But before I lived there, I dreamed about San Francisco in my monochrome San Antonio world. I thought about it every day on the way to school. One day, I'm just going to keep driving away from all the homophobic bullies that point guns at gay men from their pickup trucks. I'm going to head out west until I see the bay sparkling in the sun. I'll pull over next to one of those coffee shops I've seen in the movies, and I'll go inside and they'll all be there waiting for me. The cool, funky artists and activists that I know are waiting for me there, and one of them will be my boyfriend, tall and handsome. And we will kiss in Dolores Park and walk down the street hand in hand without fear. One day, I promised myself. And then I went to college in Philadelphia, where I was crowned queen of the Performing Arts Costume Ball so many times, they named the Lifetime Achievement Award after me. True story. And where I learned all these new words, you know, like pansexual and polyamorous and transgender and queer. And that last word fit me like a pair of fishnets.
Yeah.
And even while I was there, I swore I'd be wearing those fishnets with my boyfriend, tall and handsome, dancing in the Castro on Halloween. And we will wear high heels and false eyelashes without shame. One day, I promised myself. And then I graduated, and I moved to Austin, where I became two things I never thought I would be, a director of anarchist dinner theater and a vegetarian. And, you know, I, again, surrounded by all these amazing people, but still couldn't find that connection with other guys. And it didn't matter, though, because I swore that one day I'd be making those tofu fajitas for my boyfriend, tall and handsome. And we will march on City Hall and make love without tiring. One day, I promised myself, and then finally, the day came. I am moving to San Francisco. I am going to the Bay Area to get my PhD in English from UC Berkeley. Yeah, I used to live in San Francisco, but man, the living there was just too hard, you know? It's expansive as hell. I'm gonna meet them all, those cool, funky artists and activists, you know? And they have such attitude about me being from the South. They say things like, oh, you're from the South? I'm sorry. Well, I'm not fucking sorry. I'm gonna find them all, find my boyfriend, tall and handsome. You know, I mean, you would never talk that way to somebody. My mama would have smacked me upside the head if she heard me talking like that. And I didn't leave either until a friend of mine called me. The San Francisco that I know will mean happily ever after. She said, baby girl, it's good to be back in the South. So the same thing that happened to me happened to you. Mandatory for employees of Gay Identities R Us. Wait, not volunteer hours? Well, we're the corporate sponsors. Oh, sorry. We're one of the corporate sponsors. There's also Diesel Jeans, Budweiser, Wells Fargo. Oh, that reminds me, you came on a very special day. Today, everyone who moves to San Francisco gets their own free Abercrombie & Fitch baseball team. Where are you going? He'll be back. And I was. Oh, listen, all right? Look, just give me whatever, all right? I'm in your hands. All right, well, we have a lot of things to consider. How much of anything, all right? Well, you gained a lot of weight since I saw you last, so it's either lose weight or be a bear. I'll lose weight. All right, let's start with the basics. Aspiring yuppie gay man, better known as the Will, this is the smallest size we have. This isn't gonna fit my upper calf. I know, but just take it now and you can shrink your way into it. What do we say? Thank you. Hi, welcome to Gay Identities R Us. Oh my god, are you okay? No. What happened to you? I threw my back out doing Pilates. But that's the most basic gay workout there is. Well, I have weird shaped feet. I mean, just give me the bear, all right? Give me the bear. You know what? I think this is gonna be a good move for you, sweetie. The bears are just fantastic there. They think you are totally hot, by the way. And they throw great barbecues. I'm a vegetarian. Well, for God's sakes, don't tell them that. Just be okay. I'm sorry. Are you okay? No, it's just, do the bears not like you? No, to the club and even made out with this really hot guy. Well, then I don't see a problem. It's just. Have you ever looked out at a club full of gay men and realized that all of them, and I mean all of them, had the exact same haircut? Well, you have a lot of popular identity lines. Listen, sweetie, listen to me. I just think you would be so much happier if you just put on the Abercrombie. No! I am not wearing fucking Abercrombie. I hate Abercrombie. It just reminds me of all the things I'm not. I'm not thin. I'm not a jock. I'm not white, which you know what I never really thought about as much as when I went, moved here to San Francisco, where it is white everywhere, all the time. And every time I drive down the Bay Bridge, I have to look at that fucking Abercrombie billboard staring at me like it is the eye of Mordor. And it's just... The eye of Abercrombie, you've seen it? Yes? I'm sorry, sir. We're completely out of the identity you're looking for. We've been out of stock in 1975. Goodbye! Topher, why are we in the closet? Shh! Listen. The security cameras have already reported you. Here. Take these goggles and this headpiece. They will connect you to the network. The network? Listen. Gotta get out of here. Go to this address. You will find what you're looking for. This is in Tennessee. Why? Listen, you will find what you were looking for there. Something that fits you. Really? I promise you. Your ass will look fabulous. Thank you. Thank you. Shh. The only thanks I need is a customer well served. Now go. Go!
Well, break into my emergency supply of liquid silk lube. We need to go hard.
Alright, baby. Looks like you gotta beat those bitches on your own.
But I can't.
We need a download. We need a download. Infotech, come in.
Way ahead of you. Alright, Ramirez. Get ready for a crash course in the LGBTIQ martial arts.
Whoa! Wait. This isn't martial arts. I know this. This is choreography. Hey, boys. Nice suits. You bring lube? Because you're about to get fisted! Ha! 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 Fake! Those aren't spirit fingers. These are spirit fingers!
Oh, that was some good fighting.
Thanks. So, when do we get to the promised land? We're here. Wait, what? We're the grocery store, Rudy. You fell asleep in the car and had a dream sequence. We're the grocery store? Oh my God. I'll be right back, all right? I'll be just a second. Okay, all right. So, after the grocery store, I felt as though a great weight had been lifted. And it wasn't just that, all right? It was that every time I felt like I should go, something happened, all right? Somebody would say something or sing something, and I'd get the sense that this is where I was supposed to be. So I decided that I was going to really be there. You know, they went to the grocery store to get chips and salsa for the party and said, listen, get the chips, but let me buy the ingredients to make a salsa for this party like you wouldn't believe. Back at the mountain, back to the kitchen, where the group of very hot radical guys are still at work on that cake. And I mean, I'm not going to give any counter space until they're done, so I might as well help them, you know? So I grab some pretzels and some gumdrops and start working on it with them. Nothing like reforesting a mountainside to get to know people. And they've come from all over the country, you know? And they're all just so different and so cool. And there's one of them who is really tall and really handsome and is wearing high heels. Someday my prince will come. And when he does, it'll be all over my face. You have a salsa to make. See, my mother taught me how to make this salsa, you know, in between being a super awesome civil rights Latina activist. And so making this salsa always makes me feel like it brings out the Mexican in me, to quote from Sandra Cisneros, to steal from her, really. You know, the tomates and the cebolla, the cilantro, they all bring out the generous heart in me. The ay, mira, tú skinny, you need to eat more in me. You know, my mother's mother's mother bringing people into her kitchen during the Depression in me. Pero el ajo y los chiles, they bring out the maldita bruja in me. You shake your hips while chopping in me. You know, that my father's mother rubbed me with an egg to take off the evil eye in me. And that's right, the Latin whore that'll steal your man in me. And the canned tomatoes and the food processor, they bring out the, I have too many things to do than do this slow food movement bullshit, pinche gringo kind of thing. I mean, you know, the best parts of me go into a salsa. And through the magic of television. When that salsa was out there at the party, in its beautiful bowl, it was ready for the party. And so was I. My people, I have seen the promised land. I know that you are tired. I know that you are weary. I know that the road is long, that your back is aching and your feet are sore, but I know that nothing hurts like your hearts and your souls. So I ask you now, can you keep going? Can you keep walking? Do you want to go to the promised land tonight?
Yeah. Yes.
I said, do you want to go to the promised land tonight?
Yeah.
Well, you can't. Because it's hard to create a promised land on land that's been stolen without restitution. It's hard to build a promised land where there has been enslavement without reparations. So you can't really go to the promised land, but you can see it. You can glimpse it out of the corner of your eye. You can have it appear before you in the flash. And in that flash, you are forever changed. So I ask you all now to stand up. Stand up with me and take a look around you. These people around you have been on the same journey you have. And I say to all of you now, eat of this corn. For it is made of things that were here long before this land was colonized by violence and disease. And dip it into this salsa. Word two is made of things far more native to this land than many, many of us. Because tonight, we have friends, we have food, we have communion. Sometimes in our suppers. I ask you now to please come forth. And if you do not do the cilantro, there is some cilantro free for you. Thank you. go out to my car and I get the outfit from the trunk and close it, turn around, and he's there by his car and he's backlit. I can't see his beautiful face. But after a few seconds, it doesn't matter. Because we are pressed against the trunk of his car. And that metal is freezing. But it doesn't matter. In fact, it kind of makes it better.
Yeah.
Because that party is 1,000 miles away. And those stars are right on top of us. And we are making out. So we go back inside, and I like go into a bedroom, and I put the outfit on. And I come outside, and he's not in the living room, so I go to the kitchen. Right? I go to the kitchen, and he's not there either, so, alright, I just go out to the fire pit. The fire pit, he's not there either. And then I see this guy, he's the prince, he's really tall, dark hair, no? Okay. So I go back in the living room, and he's not there either, and it's just, anybody seen this guy? He's really tall, dark hair, dark red. I go back to the kitchen and I say, hey, has anybody seen this guy? The prince, he's really tough. No, it's high heels. Okay, so I go back up to the fire pit and he's not there and he's not in the kitchen. He's not. No. No, this cannot be happening. This cannot be happening right now. No. Is that all I get? Is that all I get after so many years? It's just 5 minutes. What was I thinking? This place? This place is just like everywhere else. But you heard that, right? You heard, you're really cute, by the way. You all heard those words, right? Because I really haven't heard those words anywhere else, not that way. You know, I mean, if this place really is like everywhere else, then that means that I'm the problem. But this place isn't, because I heard those words. They said, you're really cute, by the way, and I haven't heard them anywhere, so this place is different. If this place is different, that means that I'm not the problem.
That's right.
I'm not the problem. I am not the problem. Mm-hmm. Wow. So I'm not too fat, and I'm not too femme, I'm not too weird, I'm not too anything. I'm not the problem. The world is the problem. Mm-hmm. And if I'm not the problem, then I don't need to find the prince, because that is a stupid heteronormative story anyway. And he's not the man that I came here looking for. I found the man I came here looking for. And I will never let anyone convince me that it's my problem again. Now, if you'll excuse me, I have a party to attend. I go in, I pull my pants down, and in front of all the woodland creatures, I let go of all my shit. So the next morning, I decide, so I brought, I had 6 bricks of Mexican chocolate in my car. Because we don't leave home without it. And so I decided I'm going to make hot chocolate for everybody as a thank you. Yay. For all the things that they've done for me, all right? And so I make the hot chocolate, and I start going around in the morning to tell people what's about to happen, and that's when I run into the prince. Now, he said that he had fallen asleep somewhere the night before, and that's why I couldn't find him, all right? And by the way, in the years since I've come to know him, I discovered he has a remarkable capacity to fall asleep at parties. But at the time, I thought, you know, he probably met some other guy and wanted to make it more than you, and that's being nice, blah, blah. When this friend of his comes up and says, you know, Rudy was looking for you last night. I'm like, God, can you be kidding me? I was looking for him. So I go back to the kitchen, I finish the hot chocolate, maybe it's not as hot as it could have been. I have things to do, all right? I find him in the office where the magic happened the night before. And he's there right in the middle of the room. And he says to me those words, so perfect in their simplicity, that I will never, ever forget them. So you want to make out? All right, folks, here it is. The final round of this year's All Genders Hookup Invitational here in the beautiful Promised Land. I am your host, Fellatio. With me, as always, is my right-hand man, Mr. Cunnilingus. We have got an exciting matchup for you today between that well-known and well-loved veteran competitor known only as the Prince and a young up-and-comer. He sure hopes so, Fell. A first-time here, Mr. Rudy Ramirez. It promises to be a doozy of a man-on-man freak fest. It sure is, Fell. They're already going at it. They're in the middle of the room kissing like there is no tomorrow. You know, the Prince is a little taller than Ramirez. Ramirez has tilted his head up. Yes, but if I know Ramirez, that's exactly how he likes to play. He's sure likes to have that lower lip action. He's got the lower lip in his mouth about 57% of the time and is not afraid to use teeth. Neither am I. Honey, it's a battle royale of lips, teeth, and tongue. Uh-oh, though. Looks like we got some interference coming in. Some people coming into a check mail, check email, check messages. They probably should have chosen the conference matchup. The conference office, the office for their matchup. Yes, but you'll notice that their passionate boy kissing continues unabated and unashamed. They each got a little bit of that exhibitionist in them. But the problem here, Ramirez is having trouble negotiating the Prince's hoodie. Yes, the classic headgear headache, honey. I've seen it 1,000 times. You want to run your fingers through a man's wavy, sensual hair, and the hoodie gets you every time. Now we're enough. There's even more interference coming in. But this time, the Prince is making his move. He is shoving Ramirez up against the wall. Up against the wall? Is that a violation? Y'all, you must, you know, listen to Ramirez's gasp of ecstasy. Not only is it legal, it has made his erection even more intense. Yeah, it certainly looks that way. I mean, after all, he's finally negotiated that hoodie. They're going for that teeth attack that looked so great earlier. And they're going for it, going for it, and wait. He's stopping. The prince is stopping. He's gonna say something. Let's go to the mic on the field. Hey, so, I want to let you know, I got a call from a lover, and he has an STI. And so, you know, it's been 3 weeks, and I haven't had any symptoms, but I really wanted to know that before we went any further. Uh-oh, Phil. Looks like this is going to be over before it started, the old STI stopping block. Wait a minute, Connie. STIs may not be sexy, but respecting your partner enough to inform them fully about risk, that gives me a boner like you wouldn't believe. Let's see what Ramirez has to say. Thank you. I really, really appreciate you saying that. And there's also a lot of safe things we could do.
Yeah.
There's a bedroom in the back. Do you want to go there? Yes. Unbelievable! The crowd is going wild! They are running to the back building, setting clothes as they go! We're sharing their sexual history. Ramirez saying it's been a while since he's been tested, so he's glad they're having this conversation. And that's where Ramirez needs work if he wants to be a real player. He needs full and frequent STI screenings if he wants to move beyond hand jobs. Alright, oh wait, listen up. The prince has something new to say. I really want to come. Alright, folks, this is it. Their pants are down, their dicks are up. Ramirez is fingering the prince's puppet ass. They are spinning into their hands like seasoned Olympic gymnasts. They are going for it, and yes, the prince is over the finish line. He is coming. But that's only half the battle, Fell. Now it's Prince's. it comes. Sometimes he can't come at all from a hand job. Yes, but look at his face. He wants this. He wants to come for his blood. He loves the feeling of his sensual lips on his fingers through his hair. He is a seasoned performer, and he wants to float on one final show. He is focusing all of his energy on the tips of his penis. He is going, yes, and yes, yes, he is coming. Ramirez is coming. The prince has brought him home. So, there is no cell phone reception in the promised land. So, as I came down the mountain, I weekly called this friend of mine, Ahmad. We've been bitching for weeks about the no fats, no femmes bullshit of the gay street. Called him, I said, Ahmad, I have seen the promised land. Dollywood? No, not Dollywood. Maybe something even better than Dolly. I have seen the land of Gaynon. So, when I got home, I immediately started writing this show. It really helped a lot because the next time I went up there, you know, I was having this really bad time. And I was, wait a second, I get to poop in an outhouse and I get to make my salsa. And as soon as I did those two things, I met all sorts of awesome people. And in some cases by met, I mean fellated. And I've been there many, many times since then. You know, and it's changed. And it's, I've come to know it in all of its complications. This is not a perfect place. But right now there are people working to make it better, you know, make it more inclusive, particularly people of color and people with disabilities. And it's hard work, but I'm so happy they're doing it. You know, and it's been a while. It's been a while since I've been back. You know, work gets in the way, life gets in the way, shows get in the way. And, you know, but when I think about when I go there, I remember what it's like watching the sunset on the valley, surrounded by this posse, now, this Justice League of radical queers, all shapes and all sizes and all races and all genders and all haircuts. I think I can see the promised land from here. And well, I guess that's it. I guess there's nothing else to say.
Oh, that ain't it.
What?
You can't take your vacation in the promised land without paying it back.
That sounds good, but who are you?
The name's Sylvia Rivera, and don't you forget it.
I did forget, Miss Rivera. I am so, so sorry.
Well, you better remember me, because like I said, hell hath no fury like a drag queen scorn.
I forgot Sylvia Rivera. I forgot her name days after coming back from the Promised Land. I will never forget her again. I'm not missing a minute of this. It's the revolution. That's what you said, Sylvia, on the night the police raided the bar. On the night you decided to fight back. On the night that Stonewall stopped being a Jackson of the Civil War and became a riot in makeup and heels. It was not the first night the police raided the bar, and it would not be the last. It'd be the last time the cops could bust a gay bar unafraid. Because you fought with fists, you fought with bottles, and damn right you fought with shoes. You and Marsha, Christina, Ivana, Yvonne, you and Terry and Danny and Jerry and so many others. In Texas, we say, remember the Alamo. And just like at the Alamo, the Latinos won. You proved that the pawns of the patriarchy are no match for the queens. You fought and you kept fighting. You girded your loins and gave birth to a star. The Street Transvestite Action Revolutionaries. This star of wonder, star of light, shone out through the long night as you worked the streets with Marsha P. Johnson so that budding drag princes and princesses could sleep in a shelter alone if they wanted or with the people that they loved. This star of royal beauty bright was the first star of its kind, the first trans rights organization in the world. And when the Gay Liberation Front gave way to the Gay Activist Alliance and civil rights protections for transvestites and drag queens were taken off their platform as too extreme, you were pushed back again. Not by the cops this time, but by the people that you fought for. We're going mainstream now. We don't need you anymore. And then you uttered the words that even today make the log cabins crumble and the closets crack open. Hell hath no fury like a drag queen scorned. Say it with me, people.
Hell hath no fury like a drag queen scorned.
You came from the streets to the streets you returned. Years were lost to despair. The water beckoned to you like it did Virginia, like it does so many women too strong for their time. And it almost took you, but you are a woman who kept fighting. With the help of your friends, you went back to the streets, marching this time for justice for the murdered, and the star finally shone in the full light of day. You left us years ago, Sylvia, when we still needed you, when Victoria Arellanos was dying in an IC prison, and her death was forgotten because, Latino immigrants aren't queers, and gay people aren't illegal immigrants. I forgot your name, Sylvia. I forgot it days after coming back to the Promised Land. I was in a theater watching a whitewash, but what do you expect when you call a movie milk? I mean, nothing against Harvey, Sylvia. I know I could hang with him, but shot after shot was of white guys being arrested. No fierce Latina drag queens in sight. No mention of Stonewall. The Alamo, forgotten. There was one African-American who got one line in the movie, other than the drag queen performing at Harvey's party. And speaking of that party, what world do I live in where a white gay man can say to another white gay man about the Latino he's currently in love with, I don't have to talk politics with him. I don't have to talk intelligently to him. That's right, the gay world. Because since I came out, it's been one Latin whore after another in so many movies. And you know what? Maybe Jack Lira was unstable and preening and all the other things that Harvey's other exes have said about him. But you can't tell me he stood between those two white lovers, their relationship sanctified, poignant, and said, Harvey, yeah. The Spanish for enough. And I've had enough, Sylvia. I was saying, yeah, I could not be there with the memory of a man's lips on mine in the Promised Land and not tell him about you, but I could not remember your name. I tried, I pictured the poster, and then before I knew it, the movie was over and the credits were rolling and people were starting to stand up, so I stood up and I said, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you enjoy the movie, but you all need to know that before Harvey Milk did his work in San Francisco, you know, the movement began with African-American and Latina drag queens and queers and all these awesome people throwing their shoes and broken bottles at the cops and starting the Stonewall riots in 1969. That is the place of Latinos and queer liberation. We've always been at the forefront, and we're more than someone that you don't have to talk intelligently to. I forgot your name, Sylvia, but I'll never forget it again, because now your name is written in the trees on the mountainside. It is whispered by my lover on the trunk of his car. It is mixed in with my salsa, and everybody had a bite. I owe you my freedom, Sylvia Rivera, and I'm obliged to do you proud. So the question remains, how does queer liberation begin? It begins, like all good things, with really great sex. It begins with realizing you're not alone and never wanting anyone to feel lonely again. It begins here, there, and every day, standing against the Goliaths of oppression and disease. It begins with a choir on the Trans Day of Remembrance in Louisville, Kentucky, singing, I love you. You are important to me. I need you to survive. It is every queer who got me to the Promised Land, every queer who founded that place, every queer who is working now to make it better, and for that matter, it's every queer who stood on this stage in Austin, Texas, and told their story. It is me. It is you. It is all of the above.
Is that your final answer? Is that your final answer?